Have you ever wished you could talk with the plants in your life?
How's it going?
Are you stressed?
What's your favorite color?
Are you too hot?
Do you love me?
We can make a pretty good guess about what a plant is saying when its leaves are wilted, for example. But what if your prized pothos could let you know it was thirsty before its leaves drooped? What if a crop of tomatoes could let their farmer know that there aren't enough nutrients in the soil before they get too hungry? Or a field of rice could sound the alarm when they first detect the impact of climate change? Imagine how we could help our plants out if only we knew what they were saying. Well, we are at the Center for Research on Programmable Plant Systems to meet the scientists who are studying how our photosynthetic friends communicate. I can't wait to hear all the botanical gossip. I am so excited to be back at my alma mater, Cornell University, where I'll be spending the day with the Frank Lab. This is where all the plant communication experts are.
Margaret! Hi. It's so great to have you back at Cornell. Welcome to my lab.
Thanks.
My lab studies how plant cells and organ systems communicate with one another. You can imagine that it's really important for plants' leaves and roots to be able to coordinate dealing with life's many challenges. We want to understand the signals that they send to talk to each other and what these signals mean so that we can help crops like tomatoes improve their performance in difficult environments. Today, you'll be meeting some of my lab members and collaborators who are working on these questions. First up is Brandon, a PhD student in my lab.
So welcome to my greenhouse.
Wait, it's beautiful.
I work with tomatoes because they're easy to grow in a lab setting. They're agriculturally relevant, they feed people, and they're already feeling the impacts of climate change. And with climate change, plants are being faced with negative environmental conditions, and this can really impact agricultural output. My project centers around creating this communication system with plants so we can kind of know when they're stressed out by these conditions and when they need some kind of help.
The communication system that responds to nitrogen levels is called SEP signaling. SEPs are little molecules that act like messengers. When a plant's roots sense that there's not enough nitrogen in the soil, they send SEPs up to the shoot. The SEPs tell the shoot that the roots are in trouble, so the shoot sends more signals and resources back down to help the roots grow and explore the soil so they can find more nitrogen.
Wow, so we kind of understand this plant language already.
We do, and my project actually aims to take that to the next level. What if we could translate SEP signaling into new languages? What if we could teach plants to use SEP signaling to respond to new conditions like drought? And that's where my project comes in. My project aims to rewire SEP signaling so that plants can use it to respond to drought. So on top of that, we can't see SEP signaling happening with our own eyes. So what if we could teach plants to speak that SEP language in a way that we can understand? I want to link SEP signaling to a fluorescent signal so that it lights up in a way that we can see real time when a plant is stressed out.
This all sounds amazing, but also kind of science fiction-y. So Brandon and I are heading over to his collaborator's lab, where they can all show me what this process actually looks like in real life.
Welcome to my lab. I am Dr. Sijin Li. We are biomolecular engineers. We study plant molecules with the goal of engineering them ourselves and improving upon them. My postdoc, Dr. Yinan Wu, is helping Brandon with the first stage of his project. They are engineering plant DNAs to rewire the SEP system.
SEP signaling, drought response, and fluorescence are all controlled by different genes. So if we want to rewire the SEP system, we will need to design a unique DNA sequence that put all of these gene puzzle pieces together. We do this with the help of E. coli. So there are little DNA factories. With their help, we can produce lots of copies of a DNA puzzle.
Okay, so now that we have our DNA, it's time to put that DNA into the plant so we can give it a new SEP signaling system so that it responds to drought, but also lights up, letting us know that the plant needs water. So here's some tomatoes that have our new SEP signaling system inside of them. They start off as these wee babies. And after some time, they look like this.
Oh, they're all grown up. They graduated from SEP signaling school.
This experiment is currently underway. And right now we're looking at what we'd expect to happen with our SEP signaling system. Here, we're looking at a young tomato plant. So as you can see here, these roots are fluorescing. And this is something that we would expect under drought conditions. I chose to study plant biology because I wanted to have some kind of positive impact on the world.
The crop project is great because it is working to integrate the science that we do and apply it to the needs of the agricultural community.
Molly, I hope you had a great time learning about Brandon's amazing research.
I did.
So he's working on translating an existing plant language. Now you're going to meet my grad student, Michelle, who's working on discovering new plant languages.
Great. Hey, Michelle.
Hey.
Wait, so plants might be talking in ways we don't even know about yet?
Yeah, so I'm trying to figure out if they use a different type of tiny molecule called mRNA to signal and message to each other. mRNA we typically think of as the molecule that would make a protein, but I'm trying to see if it could have potential other functions as a signal. So basically, I'm just trying to eavesdrop on plants' mRNA to see what they're saying. I'm really excited about this because it combines my passions, which are math and biology, and I think that the most beautiful thing you can find is within a developing organism, and that's like art. And this lets me see the beauty within plants.
I love that. And I love the idea of eavesdropping on plants. How do you do that? Tell me everything.
One clue that a molecule is a signal is that it moves a really long distance. So we saw this with Brandon's steps. They move all the way from the root to the shoot and back. I'm studying if plant mRNAs do this. So which ones move, where do they move, and what might they do when they get there? A really great way to study this is with plant grafting. So I'll take the shoot of a tomato and the root of an eggplant, and I'll put these together. They'll fuse and heal, and then you have a grafted plant. And I like to call these my eggmatos.
Okay, so these are my eggies and these are tomatoes?
Yeah.
Okay. The pressure is on. I'm gonna
slice
them.
The top off. Yeah.
I'm sorry. And then it's clippy time?
Now it's clippy time.
Oh, I got it. Yes.
And that one was an eggplant.
Yeah,
so now you take the tomato shoot.
Tomato and I put it on. I just made an egg mato. Egg mato accomplished.
Done.
Farmers have been grafting plants for thousands of years, right? It's so cool that you're using this ancient technique to eavesdrop on plant mRNAs.
Yeah, these grafted plants let me determine which mRNAs are moving.
Because if we find an eggplant mRNA in the shoot, we know it must have traveled up from the root. And if we find a tomato mRNA in the root, we know it must have traveled down from the shoot. These traveling mRNAs are great candidates for being signals.
That sounds very elegant, but I am guessing it is not easy to do.
Yeah.
Eavesdropping on these plants requires a lot of intense computer power. I have to determine from millions of sequenced RNAs what came from tomato and what came from eggplant. And from there, I want to figure out what's moving and what those moving mRNAs are saying. Are they searching for more nutrients? Are they looking to flower? Or are they saying something completely else?
I'm also using fluorescent plants to determine how these mRNAs behave in different types of cells. For example, I can use these plants with fluorescent veins to help me eavesdrop on mRNAs that move through the vascular system, and these plants with fluorescent cortex to see what mRNA signals are being sent through the inner tissues. Hopefully, when we become fluent in this language, we can send mRNA signals back to plants to help them deal with things like climate change or drought stress.
Did you hear that? It's so cool. I can't wait to see what you discover. Well, I had the best day learning about all of the incredible plant communication research happening at Crop. Thank you so much for taking me behind the scenes of your science.
It's great to have you here and show you what we are doing at Crops. CROPS is unique to address future grand challenges in agriculture. It has researchers coming from all different fields to perform interdisciplinary studies. That makes CROPS unique and special.
Not only are we doing amazing science in crops, but we're also really interested in the social implications of our work. We're really interested in how our research interacts with diversity and how our projects have implications for food security and climate change. We also want to have conversations with people who are integral to agricultural communities, like students, agricultural business owners, and people who work on farms.
Yeah, like what do they care about and how we can integrate their interests into our research.
And that's where you come in. How could a better understanding of plant communication help you and your community? Let us know what you think.
Thank you for watching Science IRL. Don't forget to subscribe. And many thanks to the National Science Foundation for funding this episode.
Stay tuned for more CROPS episodes at our other institutions.